fear and worry is praise to the adversary. But I want to thank him in advance because I know that he can. I believe that he will. Right where it is that you are, I dare you and I compel and command you by faith. Would you lift up that hand? Come on, lift it up on the side of the bed. Scoot up to the edge of your couch. Right in your living room breakfast table. I want you to lift up that hand because glory and power are getting ready to come to you. Even if it is that you can hear me while it is that you're driving, keep one hand on the steering wheel. But I want you to use that other hand as an antenna. The power of Pentecost is still alive. It's getting ready to meet you right where it is that you are. I'm excited. I'm on tiptoe anticipation because I believe in the atmosphere is a season and an element for answered prayers. I'm telling you, I know for myself what prayer can do. I know that late in the midnight hour, God can turn it around. Come on, let's bombard heaven collectively. You're not in it by yourself. There's power in agreement, albeit electronically. Come on, my hand comes into agreement with your hand. Let's worship God together. Come on, open up your mouth. Would you give him glory? Would you give him thanksgiving? Would you give him honor? Hallelujah. Come on, I can't hear you. Come on, begin to bless him. Only because he's worthy. Only because he's worthy. Come on, I dare you to give it to him. What do you give the God that has everything? Give him more of it. Hallelujah. Come on. I want you to bless him.
You pray for me and watch God change me.
Come on, that's what's getting ready to happen. I pray for you.
Oh, Lord, oh, Lord.
I pray for you. Come on, everybody.
You pray for me and watch God change.
Come on, whoever you're praying for,
right,
text
now.
Them right now. Tag them right now. I pray
for you. You pray for me. Watch God change things. He's changing
on,
it for you, my brother. He's changing
everybody
it for you, my
out.
Sister.
I pray for you.
You pray for me.
You pray for me.
And watch God change things.
Come on, wave that hand, lift it up to him.
Hey,
I pray for you.
Yeah.
I pray for you.
You pray for me.
We're getting ready to go into three dimensions of prayer today. Stay right where you are. Three dimensions of prayer. First, I want to pray for this country. Pray for this nation. Pray for governmental structures. Pray for elected officials. This country is right at the precipice of an explosion. If we don't pray, that explosion can go in one direction. But with the power of God, something amazing can happen in this country. That this can finally be the land of the free and the home of the brave. If we pray, I'm believing that the oil will flow from sea to shining sea. If we pray today, you don't even realize it's an election day. God is getting ready to move some people out of position, out of authority, and he's getting ready to establish some new voices, some new leaders. Getting ready to pray that God is going to right some wrongs. He's going to shift the paradigm. He's going to tear down white supremacy. He's getting ready to build up those who have been marginalized, those who have been objectified, those who have in fact been victimized by gentrification, those of who have been unemployed and underemployed. God is getting ready to do it. Even before I begin to pray, come on, all over this room, open up your mouth and begin praying, begin opening your mouth, begin to give him glory. I'm telling you, God can't resist a wounded worshiper. When you begin to cry out on our God, God will start moving on your behalf. I believe he's going to do it. I don't even know how he's going to do it. I don't know when he's going to do it, but I believe he's going to do it.
I pray for you.
Come on, you pray.
You pray for me.
Why?
Watch God change things.
Come on, one more time, real
right
big.
Now.
We get better than
turning it around right now.
Hey,
you pray. And we're going to watch God. He's going to change it in our nation. He's going to change it in your situation. Hey, I pray for you. And I need you to pray for me.
Good and gracious God, I come to you today pleading for your mercy, pleading on your grace, pleading on your love to forgive this nation that has fallen away from your word and your character. I pray, dear Lord, that you will slain in the spirit every member of the House of Representatives. I pray that your Holy Ghost will invade the White House. I pray that you will convict, challenge, and change the hearts, the spirits, the minds of every police officer, of every person serving in the National Guard, of every attorney general, of every sitting judge, of every parole officer, of every prison warden. God, I pray that love will be the order of the day. I pray, dear Lord, that you will give those who have been discarded an opportunity to bear witness that you turn tables, that the last shall be first and the first shall be last. God, we're calling on you because we need you to touch this country, touch this nation. Because there's been unnecessary deaths, unnecessary bloodsheds, and unnecessary incarcerations. God, turn it around. Just like you got Paul and Silas out, we praise you before midnight, believing that you're going to open the door, that you're going to do things that will confound the wise. God, I thank you right now that there's getting ready to be explosion in churches, that people are gonna come chasing after you, trying to just touch the hem of your garment. We call on you, God, that you will in fact make this your nation, that you will in fact make every knee bow at your name. God, we pledge allegiance not to Democrats or Republicans, but to the cross, because God, you are the one that while we were yet sinners, you died for us. And for that, God, we're glory. And we give you praise. And we give you thanksgiving. And I praise you, dear Lord, for the shift that's getting ready to take place in this country. Do it, God. And I need you to do it right now. Sooner or later, it's going to work in our favor. It's going to turn around for us. And I believe it's going to turn around even for me. Every person who's believing by faith, things are getting ready to turn around for you. Come on, I want you to turn right where you are in that apartment. I want you to turn around right where you are in that living room. I want you to turn around right where you are in that hospital bed. Come on, open up your mouth.
Lord, will perfect that concerning me.
Come on, sooner or later.
Sooner or later. Turning my face, my baby.
It's turning around.
It's turning around for me.
It's turning around for me.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is.
Come on, it's turning around.
It's turning around for me.
Softly, watch this. It won't always be like this. The second dimension of prayer. I'm going to pray for your health today. I'm going to pray for those of you that have clogs in your arteries. I want to pray for those of you who are chained to prescription medication. I want to pray for those of you who are contending with fibroids. I'm going to pray for those of you who are dealing with diabetes. I'm going to pray for those of you that have chest pains. I want to pray for those of you that have serial migraines. I want to pray for those of you who are having difficulty in your reproductive organs. I want to pray for those of you who are dealing with a loss of sight, loss of memory, loss of vision. It's getting ready to turn around for you. Come on. It won't always be like this.
The Lord will perfect that concern in you and me. Yes, he will. That's the kind of God he is. Sooner or later. I'm here to let you know it will. Why? Because it's turning around.
I want you by faith, wherever is your area of pain, I want you to lay hands on yourself. Lay hands on yourself. Those of you who are candidates for knee replacement, lay hands right there. Those of you that are telling you're going to have to get hip replacement, lay it right there. Those of you who are having to wrestle through a broken heart, I want you to lay hands on it right there. Those of you who are dealing with any area of trauma, mental issue, mental distress, anxiety, schizophrenia, bipolar, PTSD. I want you to lay hands on your head right now. Those of you dealing with depression, I'm believing that healing is getting ready to happen. When Jesus walked the earth in physical form, the nation was undone because people no longer went to the doctor, they went to him. I'm believing by faith today that even while you're watching, somebody's going to get healed of COVID-19. My faith is set up to believe that God is going to do what the doctor didn't even see coming. That God is going to cut in half your recovery time. God is going to lower the dosage of your prescription medication. Come on, let's come into agreement. I need that hand laid on wherever your area of pain, your area of focus, your area of frustration. I'm believing that God is going to do it for you. Lord, in the name of Jesus, today I remind you of who you are. Lord, you were wounded for this viewer's transgressions. You was bruised for this viewer's iniquities. The chastisement of their peace, God, is now on your shoulders. I speak by faith that they are going to be completely healed. Those of you who resonate with that declaration of faith, I want you to type on the screen right now, I am healed. I want you to type that right on the screen right now, I am healed. You may not be completely there yet, but if you're believing that your faith is inching you in that direction, I want you to say it out loud so that the universe can hear you, so that the elements can hear you, that you are going to be healed. I believe it with every fiber of my being that healing is getting ready to happen for you. I'm telling you, the next time you go to that doctor, he's going to be completely astonished and amazed that healing has taken place. I believe for you today, Jonathan, that your healing is here. I believe that your healing is here. I don't speak it just for you as an individual, but I believe healing for the nation is here. Nation is sick. America has pre-existing conditions of racism and sexism. But it's here. Come on, your healing.
Your healing is here.
Somebody needs to hear it.
Your healing is here.
You done prayed about it.
Your healing is here.
God has already answered you.
Your healing is here.
He's already answered your prayer.
Your healing is here.
Because that's the kind of God, that's the kind of
your
God he
healing is.
Just lift your hands and receive it.
Your healing,
yeah.
Your healing.
receive it. Your healing is here right now. For your family, for your children, for your heart, for PTSD, whatever it is, whatever it is, whatever it is.
Your healing is right here. I, like you, I get tired of always hearing the problem. I want to know, is there a solution? The missing energy of what it is that we've been witnessing and watching over the last 8 days is that Frederick Douglass told us that power concedes nothing without a demand. What is the ask? Many of you have said in pop theology, I don't claim my sickness. If you don't claim the sickness, how can God get the glory out of the healing? Today, I don't want to just talk about the sickness. I want to help us navigate towards solutions. My next guest I talked to on yesterday, and he completely blew me away. I hadn't talked to him since the pandemic started, and called me yesterday out of the blue and said, Pastor, can I bend your ear? I don't like what I'm seeing, and something is going to have to change in the narrative. I hung up the phone from him. We talked, couldn't have been for 7 minutes. 7 minutes later, I called my office. I said, you got to find him. I need him here on today. I want to jump right in. I would talk to Attorney Griggs before you got here about what's been happening from Brunswick, Georgia, to Minneapolis. All of us have been glued to the television, to social media, looking at developments from marches to bonfires to looting to vandalism. But we're not hearing much in terms of solution. Today, you are carrying one. And I want you to tell the viewers about what it is that you've been working on and what you see as a winnable strategy for where America is in this hour.
Well, to your point, right now we're seeing so much. We're seeing a lot of hurt, a lot of frustration, yeah. And justifiably so. There's a lot of things that have transpired, a lot that's going on, but we can't stop there.
Yeah.
And we have to look towards the solutions, and collectively, I think we have a moral responsibility as a nation to really address bigotry and racism and to deal with some of the systemic issues that we've been facing. And so the name of our group is Millennial Civil Rights.
Yes.
And we are a nonpartisan group that is on the front lines as well, looking to really unite people with a message of unity and love, nonviolence, yes, and a call for peace during this time. And so what we're asking for, more or less, is for people to take a personal commitment. We believe change starts on a personal level first.
Yes.
And so we're asking people to commit to change. And in that commitment, we're asking people to visit wesaveus.org and really sign on to a pledge. That pledge is asking...
Say that website again. Somebody running through the kitchen trying to find a pen.
Sure.
Say it again, please.
It's wesaveus.org.
Yes.
And on that website, there's a pledge where we're asking people to commit to voting, participating in elections, both on the local and the national level,
right.
Asking people to continue wearing masks in public to protect the public at large, mm-hmm. Asking people to participate in the census to ensure that there's adequate funding reaching the communities that need it the most, and really getting that message of unity. Right now, we can't afford to be divided. We can't afford to fall for the bait, the temptation to enter into a race war. And so right now, we need unity in this country. We need leadership in this country. We need prayer in this country. Yes. And right now is the time for solutions. We've seen the problem.
I want you to recall for the viewers about what happened when they asked you to do the interview and how they wanted you to come and what was your response to it.
Sure. So recently I've been doing media appearances, and on the interview from yesterday, as a matter of fact, they asked me to wear our T-shirt, our Millennial Civil Rights T-shirt. And I said, respectfully, I'd like to decline that, because right now I think it's really important for the world, the country, to see black men in collared shirts with a different perception, a different appearance right now. If you turn on the news right now, the media is flooded with images of us and our communities looking a particular way. And right. I think it's important to add balance to the conversation and let people know that there are many shades of us. Yes. There are many shades and dimensions to all of us, different aspects of the culture. And so we need to exemplify, and that needs to be expressed. And so showing a different narrative. We control the narrative, we control the imagery, and it's time for us to put that out.
I want you to give a call because you really speak to a sector of our community that, quite frankly, our churches are not reaching. You can go into any random church and it just looks like a nursing home. I want you to really give counsel as to what is the heartbeat and the mind frame of millennials in this hour. And I need you to coach the church on how it is that we can be more in tune. This is the very first time I keep ringing this alarm that there's been a civil rights movement for black people in America, and the church is not the lead. The church is not on the forefront. And so I need you to help guide us as to how it is that we can get on board when the train has already left the station.
Well, the faith community by far is needed. And so there's definitely a need for the faith community. And a lot of times I think people forget that even the civil rights movement that occurred in the 1960s was very much so a spiritual movement.
Yes.
And so right now I think millennials and Gen Z, I think, are largely looking for inclusivity. They want to know that the church is open to them. They want to know that the church is not just taking a critical point of view, but a supportive stance in the actions that are being taken right now. Like I said, there's a lot of frustration, and people are looking for leadership and where to go, how to do things, and how to get things done during this hour. And so I think that wisdom right now, I believe strongly there's a wisdom for this generation.
Yeah.
There's a wisdom for this time. There's a wisdom for this civil and human rights movement.
Yeah.
And that wisdom is going to come from God. And so I think that inclusivity, that message of love is important from the church.
Yes.
And also being open to the idea that it may look a little different this time around. And
yes.
That's okay.
It looks a whole lot different. I am, for the first time, I'm in the category of not being a youth leader. For the very first time in my life. So this has been a real shift for me personally. And to that end, I want you to say a word to young people who are really trying to figure out where do they fit in, what is their space, what role do they play. I said to the mayor of Atlanta last week, I said, you don't even realize that all of this would have looked different if the AUC were still in session. If the AUC were still in session, they would have been out there organizing them in a different kind of way. I think the whole texture would have changed. You've got a lot of college students who are home. You've got a lot of people who are out of school and don't have direction but want to participate. And the church really doesn't fill that void for a great number of them. I want you to talk to them about how they, in a purposeful, positive, and peaceful way, can be a part of this movement.
And I think that's the key word, peaceful.
Yes.
And so we're seeing a lot of things, and we've been very vocal in announcing that if you're looting, if you know people who are looting, that's not getting us any closer to the solution right now. That's not helping us. It's actually delaying the progress that so many of us are fighting for on the front lines. What I would encourage people to do is see what their level of involvement can be during this time. I would encourage people to look at their immediate space and sphere of influence. Sometimes it's just a conversation. What we're dealing with is both the spiritual issue, but also a mentality, a mindset within this country that needs to and has to be addressed.
Talk about that, the mindset.
Sure. So when you consistently see reckless killings time after time on television and you feel a sense of hopelessness, then we have to, especially as the church, we have to instill that hope and allow people to feel that they're not helpless in this moment and that there is help, both from the support of the church and ultimately from God in this time. And so we're not void of solutions. We're not void of wisdom.
Yeah.
God knew exactly who would be in leadership, what elected officials would be in office during this time.
Yes.
And so none of this caught him by surprise, not even the pandemic.
Right.
And so we have to understand that and know that we can tap into that wisdom for our generation. And like I said, it may look differently. Yes. And each of us has a part to play. Each of us in this country have a part to play. It's not solely a black issue. It's an American issue.
Yes.
And even it's a global issue outside of that, because that perception grows and it spreads. And so we have to challenge the mentality, challenge the perception, have the hard and difficult conversations that can really lead to the change that we all desperately need and seek.
I love it. You gave me goosebumps the other day talking about a vision for black men. And I want you to talk about that vision of an activity that you want to do, and how it is that model can be replicated, quite frankly, across the country.
Sure. So I think it's important. And what we discussed was the imagery that's going out largely from the media right now. And I think that there needs to be a balance. And I think the balance that we can see and the balance that we can encourage is really a shift in a march of humanity now.
Yes.
Showing that humanity, exemplifying that humanity, and even being open to the attire being different. Mm-hmm. And what we spoke about is the power. How powerful would it be to see a mobilized group of people in suits, black males in particular, in suits,
yes,
polished, fresh, clean?
I love it.
How powerful would that be for the nation to see right now? And then also opening it up for any ally and supporter to also be a part of that. But I think it would be really powerful to see us come together in that manner. And so we're working towards that effort and making that a reality.
I appreciate you. I'm grateful for you. There is a power in numbers. You've got to organize, organize, organize. I don't want you to just move on emotion and leave your mind behind. But I need you to do both of those. New Birth is pioneering the way. Brian Keith Williams said something the other day that has arrested me. He said, we've got to, as the church, lead from the future. We got to lead from the future. Don't even deal with where it is that we now are now, but lead for where it is that we are going. You're connected tonight to a church that is making a path for the future. And I want you to partner with us, those of you who believe in the relevance of the 21st century church, those of you who believe that the church still has something meaningful and monumental. I want you to partner with us. I want you to give right now, PushPay, Givelify, or at newbirth.org. Our brother Jonathan is going to lead us for just one moment in worship, and then I'm going to come back and close us in prayer. But I want you to please, please, I want you to sow, I want you to share, and I want you to give.
You gotta finish strong. Can't give up. Gotta finish strong.
In this race that we run, you gotta have endurance, 'cause it's a marathon. I was born so rough to win, in pursuit with faith. Until the end, I'm going to have a strong
finish.
Because I have
strong faith,
I'm going to have a
strong finish.
I have
strong faith.
You're going to have
a strong finish.
Because you have
strong faith,
you're going to have
a strong finish.
You have
strong faith.
No justice, no peace.
Life's
but
transitions,
if you know Jesus, you'll always
all
have
in
peace.
My way, but still I'm onward bound each and every day. Hey, no matter what, I'll continue to run for the rest of my life. Till my work is done, I'm going to have
a strong faith.
Because I have
strong faith,
I'm going to have
a strong faith.
I have
strong faith.
You're going to have. You're going to have
a strong.
You have, you're ready to the chance, a strong finish. Hey, everybody lift it up, say, we have to the chance, a say, say. Everybody lift it up, say, we have. Since you know you got strong faith, why don't you make some noise for Jesus wherever you are? Come on. Through every step that I take, in this race, by His grace. Now come on, I'm going to have a
strong faith,
because I have
strong faith.
I'm going to have a
strong faith.
I have
strong faith.
You're going to have
a strong faith,
because you have
strong faith.
You're going to have. You can't give up, you gotta finish. Put some harmony on it, y'all strong. I promise that I'll finish.